for inviting me to take part in this session. I would like to say first that I commend very much the quality of the project output. I think it's a major contribution to the statistical analysis of the identity of independent workers. I'd like to commend it in particular because the new forms of employment have really become a realm of policy discussions at European level, but, and I can certainly look at the outputs of the Eurofound EU agency insofar, which have been interesting, in particular the latest study, but still, the categorization of independent workers has not been addressed, and I think it's a major contribution to basically getting out of the invisibility of that category of workers at EU level. So for that perspective, I would like to really congratulate the team and the consortium for the quality of the outputs. My perspective and my feedback will be very much linked to my experience. I'm not a statistician, but I happen to have specifically contributed to the analysis and the situation and working conditions of one sector in particular, media and communications, through a project that was a coordinated project by trade unions 3 years ago, the FIA, UNIME, and the European Association of Journalists. And what has, I can certainly correlate very much to the results, in particular in terms of a profile, heterogeneous profile of the independent workers, notably in terms of obviously professions, but also in terms of the type of classification of status that they have, and in particular we are facing, and it has been, I think, mentioned in the project, this complexity between the legal definitions and the statistical definitions which don't match, and that's creating and adding to the problems. The question also of the discontinuity, obviously, of work, the question of this portfolio workers, which basically juggle between different stages, different jobs, because basically they need to make a living, and obviously they cannot afford to sometimes to be only working as independents, so they tend to be also found among part-time workers. But all these status, obviously, are part of what we call the atypical work. And all these status have, of course, their difficulties and complexities. What my first, I would say, reaction and question would be is that I was a little bit surprised that there was not, you didn't choose to disaggregate the category which relate to media and communications. Because obviously this is a series of, well, it's in professional activities, I suspect. It would have been interesting to be more detailed and disaggregated on professional activities, because very honestly, when I saw professional activities, I was saying, well, what is this, basically? And media and communication has been highly populated by independent professionals, by traditions. And you have, obviously, an important part of journalists who have replied to your steps, isn't it? So I think it would have been interesting, in particular, of measuring the growth, you mentioned not the growth of the education sector, would have been interesting to have a look and say, hey, how does this sector, media and communications, doing in terms of growth compared to, as a traditional sector, compared to other sectors? So that was, I would say, my, if I may say, first key remark with regard to, I would say, the categories that were looked into. Similarly, but obviously, it was difficult for the reasons that you have outlined, in particular for the section of basically the survey that you undertook. And because of the discrepancy of, I would say, responses that put you in difficulties, but it was, of course, it could have been interesting also to have an idea. You talked about low income in particular. I suspect that this is, and you mentioned it, highly heterogeneous among type of professions. Would have been interesting to see, for instance, how ICT or real estate were independent professions are performing in terms of income. But okay, that's more remarks, but for which you have responses, I would say, in terms of the survey. Lastly, obviously, the question of collective representation and the fragmented nature of that collective representation landscape is highly relevant as a remark. I think it was probably could have been also obviously interesting, but this you have done it in more the transitional analysis and the specific reports you did on labor market intermediaries, trade unions, gas unions, etc. To see a little bit the contribution that obviously or the responses contribution that that this sector has been making or is making to addressing, I would say, the issues that those workers are confronted with, but I trust that this will be addressed through the other studies that you have, I would say, undertaken. So, lastly, in terms of, I would say, some of the conclusions that have emerged from your study and that I have the opportunity to read, you've mentioned, obviously, the issue of the lack of social safeguards, which is a key issue, and highly heterogeneous, and which has to be addressed in its own right. You've mentioned also the necessity of creating a third category that's part of the literature and the discussions that are going on in terms of legal classification, obviously. I would tend to suggest there, but again, that's a discussion that will be taking place at other probably in the other context of your project, that because of the fact that this third legal category was proposed as a response to one of the identified issues of bogus employment, and that bogus employment, according to your analysis, seems to be rather tiny, it's a tiny proportion of the workers, I believe that the reflection on the third category, if we decide to go there in terms of policy recommendation, should probably be broader in trying to address the problem. It should not be used only to address the problem of bogus employment. It should be used also to mainly address the situation of those workers which fell in the loopholes or are out or are really part of the loopholes of social protection because mainly of discontinuity. That the big problem that we're facing in social protection across member states is all those independent professionals who had this discontinuity out of their daily career and who cannot meet the thresholds for social protection. What are we doing with those kind of workers, basically? So I guess that if we're talking about creating a third, let's say, legal category, which has been the case already in certain member states, as you mentioned, but mainly for addressing professional bogus employment, it should address more broadly the loopholes. So that's, I would say, my remarks, but more really clearly, I'd like to commend the contribution of this project very much. Thank you.
So, first of all, thank you very much because me too, I appreciated the attempt to overcome the limits of the approach proposed by Rappelin, even if it is pretty interesting and it was really useful to renovate the focus on self-employment. At the moment, the approach of Rappelin is not a standard approach. It means that someone used this approach. There are some problems, but of course, in terms of data analysis, we need to improve more some aspects because it's quite difficult to frame a common and a standard analysis on self-employment. Due to the problems, the structural problems of
data database, the European database, but the national too, of course. So, if we have to try to summarize in one word, not in one word, but I would like to say that the goals of the survey were numerous and were really interesting because the survey tried to face a lot of important dimensions, such as labor markets, working conditions, welfare system, regulation system, representation, and social life, I think. And we have some answers on all these dimensions. And if we can, if we try to summarize in one word the main conditions related to all these dimensions, we have to speak about fragmentation. Fragmentation of labor markets because self-employed are in a lot of sectors, and of course it's quite difficult to understand the real condition of self-employed in a lot of sectors because they are facing different everyday working conditions, different labor market dynamics. They have sometimes different problems, and so the knowledge we need to understand them is higher than in comparison to the knowledge we needed in the past to understand employees. So the survey was a really interesting attempt to improve the knowledge, and that's important. I think that one of the directions we need to follow is to improve these attempts. So, when we speak about labor markets and self-employment, we need to face a global dimension if we focus on crowd workers. We need to face a national dimension because labor markets, the same labor markets are different in different nations. But we have also to face the regional dimension because self-employed are not homogeneously spread all over a national territory. We know for certain, for example, that in Italy are concentrated in the north, and that says something about their strategies, about the labor markets and the attempts they are doing to face the changes of labor markets. So, if we speak about welfare system, we can understand really well from the survey that they are not, they are marginally included in the welfare system, except for the example of Sweden and Netherlands too. But we need to recognize that they are strategic in the labor market, but not protected as employees. So that's the point, and I think that is an issue really important, and also institutions are reflecting on that, but we are at the beginning. About the regulation dimension, we need to consider the attempt of Europe at the European level to suggest some directions, but suggestions are still really weak. Really weak. Okay, that's the point. At national level, we need to consider that each nation acts alone with specific rules, specific strategies, specific neoliberal ideas, usually, if we exclude some example in the north of Europe. And that's the point where Europe wants to go as a collective subject. And I think that we can speak about a little bit more about representation, and in the morning or in the afternoon we will speak about also organizations representing self-employed, but we have to recognize also that fragmentation is within organizations representing self-employed. But the good news is that, again, we are at the beginning. If we consider what happened, what was happening at the beginning of 2000, we need to recognize that there were not so many organizations as now. So I think that that is good news. And in the end, social dialogue. We will speak about that in the afternoon. We need to understand if there is a new level of a new social dialogue, because at the moment, social dialogue related to self-employed is mainly informal. I mean, it happens through lobbying, sometimes through coordinated lobbying, but not because we have an institutional framework. And the surveys say that self-employed are more interested in coalition building, because they recognize that they are fragmented, and they recognize that there is no chance to win if they focus only on one organization. The complexity of the working environment requires a coalition to face the problem. And so, in the end, I would like to say that the study of self-employment is strategic also because the conditions experienced by self-employed are quite similar, are really visible now, but are becoming quite similar also to the conditions experienced by employees in terms of flexibility, in terms of quick changes in the labor markets, in terms of instability, not in terms of welfare system, but nobody can say that the welfare system for employees is becoming better. So it's a common problem, not only for self-employed, even if self-employed are experiencing the worst condition in terms of welfare system. So, okay, I can stop here, and thank you very much, and I hope that there will be other opportunities to develop such a survey. Thank you.
So we are in advance. Incredible. And so I propose a coffee break, 10 minutes, and then we start.